Hello, and now we start the lecture number 5 about efficiency in the selfish load balancing games. So that's a very, very, very widespread area, load balancing, scheduling, and so on. Often, this is studied from the algorithmic point of view. So how can a single optimizer improve, find the best schedule, for example? We, on the other hand, are going to add the strategic concept, the strategic view, assuming that, for example, each task is deciding by itself, so each task has an owner who decides by his or herself to which machine to go. And so we now have a strategic interaction in addition to this load balancing. And that's something which people actually often do, which is called the operational research games, in short, OR games. So that's a game based on some operational research problem. It was one of the famous operational research domains is indeed load balancing and shading. So that's something which is very central. How can we look at this known things called scheduling from a strategic point of view? And let's get into that. So what is the basic idea? Basic idea is, as I said, that game theory now needs to be introduced into maximum minimization when tasks are basically associated with agents. So each task is ruled by an agent, and the agents are selfish. Utility basically depends on how much it takes for that task to be executed. And so it's important for us now to study what is the efficiency of such, eventually the equilibria, and how fair that is. If we want also to have some notion of fairness, which we of course need to define. And the application are indeed ubiquitous. So you have a lot of possibilities to use that. So for example, of course, all this internet related stuff, or even not internet related, but it can be also local, that you download something from a server, or you upload requests to servers. And of course, you are interested mostly in what happens to your request, but you need to take into account what the other users of these servers might do. If you know that everyone uses a certain server, then even though that server may be quick by itself, you might decide to use another server. And so there is definitely an importance to think about the interaction, about what the others do. That's the interaction. Also, you can think about users scheduling their processes for execution on servers, but doesn't have to be bound to computers. It can be also dispatching jobs to employees. You can think about how quick your task, if you have several managers, how quick will your task be done, considering what the other managers might want from those employees. So basically everything which relates to scheduling and to load balancing, which is basically a lot, everything can be studied from such a perspective. And now we define 4 models, which of course are related around the same thing. And we study their price of anarchy. So how bad can an equilibrium get? And we study also the complexity of getting to an equilibrium. That's also not a trivial question. As I may have said, so definitely not proven, there is a known proof that the finding of an equilibrium in a general game, I am saying general, is quite hard. It's harder than problems which are known to be hard. So-called PPAD complete. And what it means is that we don't expect to find a nice algorithm for a general game. It of course does not preclude us from finding an algorithm for a complete class of games. Or finding an algorithm in which a game works efficiently for a complete class of games. We have a lot of stuff we can do, but in general, find an equilibrium is a hard task, so we need to look at this again and again for each new philosophy. Also, one question is, of course, what about the agents finding? It can be that we can find the equilibrium if we just have, if we just run a certain algorithm, but how can the player find an equilibrium? Well, that's also an important question. Someone famous, I forgot who said that, that if my laptop cannot find an equilibrium, it means that the market can't either. And I'm not sure that's the case, especially if you allow for a certain approximation or an approximate. But definitely it's a non-trivial question how to find an equilibrium, especially how to do it practically. So let's look at the model from a general point of view. All the four models I mentioned stemming from the same original model. So that's the more general model that we are looking at. So consider makespan scheduling on uniformly related machines. So I have M machines which are uniformly related. So they may do everything. One machine may do everything. Another machine may do. The only question is what is the speed? That's what it means here that they are uniformly related. And the speed is simply a number. So the speed of machine I is SI. And there are n tasks. So this square bracket means as the numbers, the natural numbers between one and this number in the bracket, including both one and number in the bracket. So that's simply a shortcut. So there are m machines, m tuples, machines, and there are n tasks, basically are identified with certain players, which are used by another player. So this is the player set of the game, and their weights are w1 to wn. The weight is simply the size of the task. That's the idea. Maybe the weight is, I'm not sure that's the most intuitive name, but that's the one the book uses, the algorithm game theory book uses. So let's stick to that name. And even an assignment, which is basically a strategy profile where each task goes. So the strategy of each task is simply where that task goes. The A of that task of I is the strategy of the task, and the whole strategy profile is the assignment. So given an assignment from N to M, function from N to M, now we need, having defined those who participate, task class, and having defined the strategy space, the assignment, we need to define the cost. In this case, it's going to be the load, basically, of the machine where the task is. So first, the load of machine J is simply the sum of the total execution time of all the tasks I which go to that machine, AI is equal to J. We look at those tasks. We look for each one of them, the weight, so size in other words, divided by the speed of the machine. That's how much time it will take to execute the task. And the total sum of those is simply how much time the machine will have to run. That's the law of machine J, LJ. Now, the cost of a concrete task is the load of the machine where it has go, L of AI. That's the cost of I. And the makespan, in other words, is social cost. That's what we call makespan, which is a traditional name from scheduling, that's going to be defined as the maximum load. When does the last machine finish? So the maximum load of all the machines, that's the maximum. And the objective is, of course, in the sense of the consideration, like we looked at what is the social cost, how can we minimize that, or say, how close is the social cost in equilibrium to the minimum social cost. So the minimum social cost is simply defined the minimum makespan. So the objective is to find, if you look at this from a point of view of an optimizer and not what happens in a game, that an assignment O here is an assignment, not the asymptotic notation, here is the assignment. which minimizes the social cost. Okay, that's the basic definition. And now, if we assume that all the costs are 1, all the speeds are 1, if we assume all the speeds are 1, then this is a particular case called Makepan scheduling on identical machines, because then they're not just uniformly related, they're just identical, because the abilities of each machine is simply what is the speed. That's the only difference that they could have, and if the speeds are the same, that simply means that they're the same, so then it's called Makespan scheduling on identical machines. And that's something we also have seen before. Now, this topic is, as I said, usually studied algorithmic schedule. Now, the question we pose here is, what if there is no central authority, but rather each player, or in other words, each task, just chooses where to go such that it optimizes his own makespan? What happens then? And so the intention of this chapter is to consider makespan, first of all, because it captures both efficiency, when does the last machine finish, and the fairness, because we want to minimize the time where the last task is done. That's something which considers also fairness. It's not like enough. If you consider the sum, for example, of the latencies, so let's say we consider the sum when each machine, so I am done at this time, you are done at the other time, so each task is dealt with at another time, and we just look at the average or the sum another. That would be basically what is the efficiency without thinking about how fair it is. Maybe that one task is finished really early and the other task has to wait too long, and whatever happens, you don't like that maybe. So in this world, here we look at this last task. That's what I mean by fairness. So in that sense, it's a nice way to model this. So we minimize this maximum load. That means that we look at the fair. Of course, that does take a toll at how much we think about efficiency, because it means that we don't really distinguish between the two assignments. One assignment where you have every machine having the same, pretty much the same time to run, and the maximum load is something. Another assignment when you have basically most machines finish early and only one machine has to run more. If the maximum is the same, that's the same for us. But of course, in reality, if there are most machines who finish early, that does help some tasks. So you do think of that as a more efficient assignment. So thinking of fairness definitely takes a toll in how we think about efficiency. And the second point is that we also will consider mixed Nash equilibria, and probabilistic, independent probabilistic take on that. So when those players randomly choose where they go, and then you have this uncoordinated random behavior, that allows us to think about what happens if they're indeed random, or if they are not sure, or if they play the same scheduling game many times, the average is represented as something random. So that definitely is an important thing to consider, mixed equilibrium on the pure. So the agenda is to first look at the general model, in a bit more detail than what we have done now, and then to study the following concrete instantiations of this model. So first, what are the Nash equilibria and their efficiency on identical machines? We have the same. Usually we look at this, assume they have all equal to 1. What happens when you have uniformly related machines? So you have some speed given, maybe not the same. What happens when we look at the mixed equilibria on the identical machines, and what happens when we look at mixed equilibria on uniformly related machines, whereby allowing this uncoordinated optimization. And then if we look and if we bound the price of anarchy for those cases, it definitely is a strong bound, if you are able to. So let's first look at the model in more detail before we dive into one of those four models. By the way, before I just go further, I remind you that we did have a taste of this topic a little bit in the second lecture. We looked about scheduling, because we looked at a very small part of what we're going to do now. But also, I remind you, we did look at the mixed and at the pure equilibrium. But we looked also at something we don't plan to do here, which is the social cost being defined as the sum instead of the maximum law. That's something which is different, the sum of the laws. Okay, so let's get load balancing games model deeper. So each task, or in other words, use those interchangeably here, agent, it's a machine. That's a strategy. That's the strategy of an agent. What is the machine? Where to go? Now, a pure strategy proper, therefore, is a role. Of agents to machines or task to machines, in other words, and the cost of such an agent in such an assignment is the load of the chosen machine. So that's the load of the machine where agent I go. Now that's basically the definition of the pure, the original game, and the social cost is the maximum, the sum, as I said, that's the maximum load of the machine. Now, what is the mixed strategy? A mixed strategy is the vector of probabilities. Basically, you randomly allow those to randomly each one independently of the others to choose where that person goes. So, for each player I, you can write this distribution over the machines as simply what is the probability you go, not you, what's the probability I go to machine I, PI, machine me, 1 is PI in the subscript, 1 in the superscript. What's the probability player I goes to machine 2 is PI 2, and so on. In general, that's PIJ, the probability that player I goes to machine J. Well, that's a mixed strategy. And mixed strategy profile is, of course, a vector of such vectors of probabilities. PIJ, when I can be any player and J can be any machine. Now, for any I and J, we define XIJ as a classical analysis, probabilistic analysis, as the indicator of the event that AI is equal to J. So that random variable is equal to 1 if AI is equal to J. This comma is, of course, and it's 0 if AI is not equal to J. That's the definition of indicator random variable. So you have the mixed strategies. Those are the mixed strategies and the cost, of course, the expected cost. Now, first we look at what is the expected cost of a given machine under some P, probability distribution of the agents. So that's simply the sum of all the agents. We look how much does a certain agent, or in other words, a certain task, we use those words interchangeably, what does this contribute to that machine? So if xij is 1, it contributes something, otherwise it contributes nothing. That's why I multiply the contribution, size of task divided by the speed of the machine. I multiply it by xij. That's the convenience of those random variables, indicator random variables. And now we use the linearity, that's the classical way, the linearity of expectation. It does not depend on anything else, like dependent, independent, anything. If you have a sum, the expectation is simply the sum of the sum, is the sum of the expectations. And of course, what is the expectation of xij? It's simply the probability because I is equal to j times 1 plus the probability I is equal to something else times 0. So basically PIJ, probability I is equal to J is defined as PIJ. It's denoted as PIJ. How PIJ is defined. So that's what happens. That's the value of a machine. So look at all the tasks. what is the probability of task I goes to J, and then I multiply it by how much I would, how much load, how much time would it basically incur for that machine. Wi divided by Fj. Now the social cost is defined for the case as the expected maximum, so it's expected the social cost of a probabilistic strategy profile, of a mixed strategy profile, is the expected social cost, is the expectation of maximum. Pay attention, it's not the maximum of expectation, these are not the same things, it's the expectation of maximum, that's how we define it. Because the maximum of expectation would be something else. In general, so that's an important thing. Now let's in this slide shortly recap what we've done and go further. So ith cost is the load of the chosen machine. Social cost, the social cost under everything here, those two first lines are for pure choice. The social cost is the maximum load. Then a mixed strategy is a vector of probabilities, where Pij is basically the probability player I chooses to go to machine J. And we define the social cost in the mixed case as the expected value of this social cost in the pure. So we look at what is the social cost of a pure assignment. Well, pure assignments are distributed according to. And now, agent I's expected cost on a given machine. So Cij, that's how we define Cij as the expected cost of a machine J conditioned on agent I choosing that machine. That's what agent I's cost is if she chooses that machine. Now that's not the same as the cost of the machine. The cost of a given machine, the expected cost of a given machine, that's something else. Here we didn't assume anything. But here we assume that at least agent I has to go there. The other agents, we know it's independently chosen, they do something, whatever they do. So what is that? For any mixed profile we have. So agent I surely contributes her Wi, and the other contribute whatever the expected value is, given that they may not go to the machine. And all this expected load is divided. Y divided by the size of the speed of the machine. So that's equal to the expected cost of the machine, if you didn't assume anything, plus something which depends on what's the probability of agent I choosing the machine. So this probability can be only equal to the probability of the expectation. The expected cost of a machine J conditioned on agent I going there can be so the expected cost of agent I when she chooses machine J is equal to the expected cost of machine J without any assumption. If and only the probability that agent I choose machine J is 1. Because then the assumption is basically meaningless. We know that that's the probability 1. Unless that's the case, then of course the expected cost of the machine is smaller, strictly smaller than the expected cost of the machine when we assume that that agent has chosen the machine, because then the assumption actually gives us some extra information. We know that the agent already definitely contributes her Wi divided by Sj to the time of the machine. So that's actually very intuitive. That's what we also shown now formally. The expected cost of an agent without any assumption, the expected cost of an agent in a given mixed profile is the expectation of the log of machine A high. So that if your load of an agent goes, and the expectation is the expected cost of the agent. And using simply the formula of a full expectation, the expectation of the expected value of a random variable is equal to the expected value of that variable conditioned on a subset of what can happen on some event times the probability of actually that condition that event. And those events need to be first exhausted. They need to get to cover all the space they have. And second, they need to be they may not intersect. So we just need to divide this space. Also, of course, they may not have probability zero. Well defined. Condition probability on something is probability zero. So we have basically, mathematically speaking, a partition of roles of the whole space, whole probability space, sample space, and the expected value of the load is the expected value of the load conditioned on being in one element of the partition times the probability of being in that element, and the sum of all the elements of the partition. So, in other words, look at the expected value of the load conditioned on actually agent I go into the place times the probability agent I go to the place, Pij, and the sum of all the Pij, all the machines such that Pij is strictly greater than zero, so that this event has a probability greater than zero. So now we can substitute this formula instead of the expression. Okay. And now, what about having defined this viewer and mixed model games? What about Nash equilibrium? So, in a general game, a strategy profile is a Nash equilibrium if for any player and for any possible deviation of player from this last strategy in the strategy profile. The cost of that player, I'm now formulating that in the terms of cost. So the cost does not decrease from EI changing to ECI, SI changing to SI prime when the others do what they used to do, S minus I. Because the security could not increase. The security does not increase. But the cost does not decrease. Now, for our game concretely, we can just translate the general definition to our game, and that's an assignment. Is a Nash equilibrium if for any player and for any change of the player's assignment, so I primize another machine, the load of that player when it goes to another machine and the others do what they used to do is at least what the load of that player when she went to the machine she used to go AI was. So the load does not increase. Does not decrease from a unilateral change of where the player goes. Now, for mixed extensions, what we have is in general again the same thing. For any player, because a mixed equilibrium is basically a pure equilibrium of the mixed extension. So it can be said that in general, a mixed extension has an equilibrium if is the mixed extension equilibrium, if for any player and for any another probabilistic choice of the player for any other strategy, AI prime, the log of the machine where the player goes under this new strategy should be PA prime. It should be also PA prime. Let me change that. So now I've changed it. And so now we have correctly. So for any possible relation to another probabilistic strategy, to another mixed strategy, the log if I deviates while the rest don't change what they used to do, the log can only increase. Now, and there is this general characterization of a mixed Nash equilibrium, which in the language of our game, so for our game, sounds like that. The mixed profile is a Nash equilibrium, is a mixed Nash equilibrium, if and only for any player and for any possible action, your action, plan, the probability of that machine, that action, is positive only, can be only if that's an optimum. So only optimum actions can be in the support of that P. And what does it, how do we write it using machine J is optimum? We write that for play I, Sj costs at most as any other Sk. And I remind you that Sj is how much the player experiences given that she chooses that machine. So choosing a machine J costs at most as much any other thing it costs, so that's an optimum choice. So the supports, in other words, those who get a positive probability, are only of among those who have optimum, for optimum. The only optimum pure strategy can be the support of an objective. Not necessarily all pure strategies have to be in the support, but all those who are in the support have to be optimum. And we already proved that actually, when we just introduced this topic of mutualistic equilibria, now we prove that again in the general setting for any finite game. So we just recall mixed Nash equilibria in order for you to feel more comfortable.